Okay, so I just want to show you a couple things that we do have in the ground right now. Right now we're still getting some nights that can go below 40 degrees. So that's kind of iffy when you're planting new plants. And if you're putting seeds into the ground, a lot of times those seeds won't germinate just yet. So we're kind of right at that point. So our last frost date was April 15th, which means after that we should not get anything that drops below freezing or below 32. But that's not always the case. Like just last week we had a frost night and we had actually a snow flurry during the daytime and then it dropped below 32. So I think we're out of that now, but that doesn't mean that we can just go ahead and plant brand new seedlings. But these strawberries that we have right here, these are actually plant starts. So we bought these from a nursery and these are last year's strawberries. So a strawberry, it'll send out a bunch of runners from the main plant. Like we space these about a foot apart, allowing for those runners to have some room. So this plant, one thing that you have to kind of know when you're planting something for spacing is how big it'll be when it's fully mature. So this strawberry plant will be about a foot wide. So 6 inches radius, and then it'll be about a foot wide. So these looked very similar to the way they do now. These have been in the ground for about a week and they've already put out some new leaves. If you look at this one, this is all new leaves. They're doing really good here. I got 25 of these strawberries and I put 5 over under the peach tree. I'll have to show you guys an update of that. But we have about 15 of them right here. So I kind of was doing an experiment to see if they would benefit from having the wood chips as a mulch. See if it will keep it a little bit more moist. They already do have a lot of this rabbit manure on top that will act sort of as a mulch, but I'm kind of experimenting. Right now I can't see any huge differences, so I covered half. So up to this flag right here, this is strawberries. And then if we move down this way, I have turmeric and ginger and garlic in here. So there's a row of turmeric. Ginger. These are both rooting root crop. What I did is I just went to Whole Foods and I bought organic turmeric and I bought organic ginger and I bought organic garlic and then I just planted them. If you come closer, so at the end of this turmeric and ginger and garlic, here's the garlic and it's already starting to come up. So I space garlic throughout the garden. I'll put this probably every 15 or 20 feet or so. And garlic is a real good pest repellent. It deters a lot of things because of its strong odor. You do kind of have to be careful because some things will take on its flavor. Like if something is really sweet, like I didn't plant it right next to the strawberries, sometimes it'll interfere with it just a little bit. I've noticed that. But we're about 6 feet away from those strawberries. So there's garlic here. And then we started what they call sweet potato slips. So what they'll do is they'll take a sweet potato and they'll put it in water and then it'll start to sprout out and it'll start growing a bunch of little, what they call slips. And you, from one sweet potato, if it's a large sweet potato, you could probably get 20 or 30 of these little slips. So that basically makes it so that you don't have to divide the potato or plant the whole potato so you don't lose the potato. I like a different method actually. I like to, when I'm digging up potatoes, whether it's sweet potato, red potato, russet potato, any kind of potato, what I do is I dig them all out and then I find the largest one, the one with the most eyes, and then I just put that back in the ground. Right as I'm harvesting, I just dump that back in. And then that one, because it has the most eyes and it's the largest, it makes the most potatoes for the next year. But we went this route. We got 20 of these slips at this nursery and they were like 20 for $2. So they're relatively inexpensive. But I'm gonna show you another area where I just bought potatoes, organic potatoes, and just put them directly in the ground. So from here to that flag, that next flag, there's sweet potato slips. When they're just little starts, they're actually not doing very well. There's probably only 3 to 5 out of the 20 that are doing very good. So I think what happened was it was actually too cold at night and these are just freezing back. So we're kind of pushing the envelope. We're trying to get in as soon as possible
But it is a little too early for some things that have real leafy leaves. So those things tend to freeze.
All right, so let's have a look at these. If you want to come down and just kind of look at some of these.
Okay, so one thing that I'll point out is we didn't plant the sweet potatoes right in the middle, because a sweet potato, this one sweet potato, here's one that you can tell had a hard time. It's all frozen back. This one's doing pretty good. You know, when you plant something and you put it in the ground, a lot of times you have a shock period that may be a couple days to a week where it kind of gets set back. So these have already gone through the shock period. So it's hard to say whether the shock period got it or the cold, because I mean, these are right next to each other and this one's doing okay. I can actually still see new leaves coming off of this one. This one just looks like it's having a really hard time. It's all crusty. But my point is that we set this back. We didn't put this in the middle so that it would fill up the entire bed. We set it back. And then this over here is kind of a dead space. We're trying to kill all this grass here. So we'll actually, once this starts growing out, we'll grow this way where there's nothing growing. So from this point on to here, we still have that open garden bed space. And then we'll allow these sweet potatoes, all the leaves and stuff, because they put out a ton of leaves. This one plant, it'll probably be about 4 foot by 4 foot. But we'll just push this out this way. So here's another slip. Here's a slip. We put these about 2 feet apart. Probably closer to 3 feet apart. One thing I'll point out is all the rabbit manure. The same place that we got these tarps from and the white plastic, we also got this rabbit manure. The guy has about 60 rabbits that he breeds. At one time he had like over 200. That's where we got this rabbit manure from. And there's still more. We probably didn't even get half of it. And we actually started collecting it. If you look down that way, you can actually see a pile down there of excess that we have. Some of the rabbit manure was actually like saturated in the rabbit urine. So that completely changes it. Like if you just have these little pellets like this, these are very neutral. And those you won't have an issue with. But if it's saturated with the urine, which some of this is, and that's why it gets clumpy like that. A lot of times you just have an influx of nitrogen. There's just a super high amount of acidity. That may be what's causing this plant burn. So it's kind of hard to tell. And this is kind of something that you're gonna fight with the first year of gardening. You're kind of trying to create a balance in your soil. So it never works out perfectly all the time. It's not like, oh, you try something and it just works out. I think as the rabbit manure breaks down and the rain kind of has a chance to dilute it a little bit and spread it out and it's not so concentrated, I think it's gonna be fine. So here's another one of the sweet potato starts. Here's one that's doing really good. That one's probably doing the best. That was the largest one already and it had the best root system. So I think possibly there's a couple of variables that I think might have affected it. So it could have been the cold. Some of them, it could just be the shock of moving it into the soil where it went from like a very neutral pH. So once they get the roots to come out, they put it in this stuff called perlite. You've probably seen it in potting soil. If you get potting soil, it's got these little white pellets or pebbles and they're real like airy. So they just take that. It's 100% perlite, and then they put these sweet potato slips. So they take these slips and they put them in the perlite so that they'll start to root out. So maybe what I should have done was put it in perlite. I actually have some perlite that I bought when I bought these for doing rootings. And maybe I should have put it in the perlite and allowed the roots to come out a little bit more so that it would have more of a root system. So that could be a variable. Or it could just be, like I mentioned before, it could be the soil that I put it into was too acidic because of all of the rabbit urine that's in these rabbit droppings. So up to that flag right there, these are all sweet potato slips all the way down through here, and there's 20 of those. So if you can imagine from this point, this will all be filled up with leaves that look like that. Sweet potatoes really vine out. They cover a large area. So That's the plan here. And then beyond that flag, there's more sweet potatoes. Let's go down there. Okay, so that flag right there, that's the stop of where we did the sweet potato slip. So then from that flag to the end of this bed, we put in basically whole sweet potatoes. So there's about 15 in there, and they're about every 2 feet apart. There's a sweet potato. I was actually just looking pretty closely, and I saw the first leaf pop out. So the ground is getting warm enough, and these are starting to come up. So like a whole sweet potato, it'll be way ahead of these slips. These slips will take a while to create that main potato root, and then it'll take a while to branch out. But when you have a whole potato, it already has. I mean, what you're eating when you're eating a potato is you're eating a storage sack for that plant. It can last a long, long time. It can last through a winter, it can last through drought, it can last a long time. In case it has a very difficult stretch where it's not getting the correct nutrient, the top, whatever's above the ground, may die off. It has a storage bank, so then it can shoot back out again and start over again once the conditions are right, once it's moist again and cool enough or warm enough. So these sweet potatoes, they'll do better as a whole potato than the slips will. So that's what's going on here. And those are planted every 2 feet. So here's another little patch of garlic. There's about 10 little garlic cloves right in here. That's what all these are. They kind of look like small grass, but those are all garlic right in there. Let me just point out too, this area right here, whenever we get cardboard, we take it over here and we use that as a mulch. That suppresses the grass from coming in. It's kind of doing the same thing that the plastic does. If we had enough cardboard, we wouldn't even use the black plastic. We just don't have enough, so we used what we had. But as time goes on, we'll keep adding the cardboard, because what that'll do is it'll suppress the weeds, but then it also encourages the worms. I mean, under these cardboard right here, there's probably a couple hundred worms. I'll lift up some cardboard and I'll show you guys what that does. Okay, I told you guys I'd show you some worms. This is an area right in the middle of the garden. And what I did is I have some areas where I have cardboard already that I was experimenting with how quickly it would kill large clumps of grass. And what I found after I left the cardboard there for a couple months is that the worms just like gravitated to that area. So let me point out right away, you can see how moist this soil is. So the cardboard, see, there's a worm there. The cardboard actually kind of mimics like the forest floor. It creates a barrier that the forest floor would get from getting leaves year after year after year, and it just creates a super little microclimate right at the surface. Like, if I'll explain this soil to you, it's really super cool. Like, if I fill this stuff out here, there's a little warmth to it, but under here it's super moist and super cool. And you can see the worms in here. If you ever have worms, you don't want to keep them out in the light too long, because the sun will kill them. That's why they hide under the ground. The idea here was to create a little worm haven, and then the worms would spread out throughout the garden. So I just am kind of experimenting to see if that truly is the case. I'm kind of hoping that they'll get on track with all this rabbit manure, and they'll just kind of infiltrate these garden beds and move out by putting them right in the middle here. Okay guys, so now we move back to the south end. This is bed number 6 that we just showed you, that had all the strawberries and the sweet potatoes in. That's to this side, so that way's east. Starting that way, that would be row 1, 2, 3, 4, and then this is 5 and this is 6. So from the end there all the way down to that flag, there's strawberries in here every 1 foot. So there's probably, I went to Walmart and I got 6 packages of these strawberries, and they have these bare roots, and they're completely dormant. They don't have any leaves on them. They're about $3 for a 10 pack. So I got 6 of those. So I put about 40 strawberries right in here. And then if you can see way down there where there's more of this grass down there where it looks real dry. So I actually started down there, and then I was like, oh no, what am I doing? The sun is coming from this direction. So like strawberries, they don't get very tall. Like max, they get here. So all of the shorter things like your lettuce, your strawberries, your onions, anything that's gonna stay low, you want to put that farther south, because if the sun's coming from this direction, like right now the sun's coming from right behind you. If the sun's coming this way, if I put something taller in front of, say, like the strawberries, like if I put the peas or the tomatoes or okra or beans, something that gets 3 feet tall and then it gets all bushy, if I put it behind, it's gonna shade out that crop. So like the strawberries, I actually needed them at this end. Now that's not gonna be that big of a problem because sweet potatoes are on this end and then there's nothing tall on this end. And even if there is, it's far enough away. As long as it's not more than about 3 or 4 feet, it shouldn't hardly cast any shade on there. So the thing that saves me is that there's nothing tall on this row number 6. So there is strawberries from here to that flag, and then right down the center, about every 2 feet, I got asparagus. And I'll show you our one little token asparagus. Those just started popping up. Well, one of them did. Check this little dude out. So here he is, there's the first one to pop out this year. That's an asparagus. So it's just starting to get warm. It's pretty neat. Everything's just kind of starting to get out. Here's another garlic that we just put in random places. And then beyond this flag, from this flag to this flag, is carrots. Just a standard orange carrot. So that's what's from here to there. And then if you look back to this other row right here, this would be row number 4, from the end there, this is all red onion, all the way until this little number 4 looking thing for row number 4. So from here to the end, which is about, it's probably about 35 feet, this is all red onion, and those are planted really close. There's probably 5 of them. Actually, here's one right here. This is what they look like. You can get these for like 200 for like $1. They call these seed onions. So this is what we plopped in right here, and those should be coming up anytime now. We planted those really close together. You can kind of see the divots right here. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So they're really tight. I mean, an onion's only gonna get about this big. If you know how they grow, they don't really have any leaves on them. They just have like little tubes that come out. They hardly take any space because they're not gonna cast shade on other stuff. So this is all onion. That's actually all that's in this row. There's nothing in row number 3 yet. And then in row number 2, that is our grass row. That's the one that we had tons and tons of grass in, so we're just kind of waiting on that. We keep adding more mulch to that from grass clippings. It has a layer, if you look in there, you can see it has a layer of rabbit manure, but then we're just keep on adding the grass clippings to kill the grass that's growing underneath it. So we're kind of waiting on that one, and we're not gonna plant into that one. And then that white plastic, that's back to row number 1, and we're gonna put some peas in there today. Oh, let me show you one little area that I started prepping right here. Okay, so I prepped out this area basically from this number 4 to the cardboard, and then actually about another 6 or 8 feet beyond that wood there, I prepped this all out for lettuce. So I just got it real nice and flat, made sure it was real crumbly. I broke down all of these real clumpy things and got this ready for lettuce. So I'll probably plant out some lettuce in here today or tomorrow. And this will be like a romaine lettuce and a Simpson lettuce, and then maybe like a spring mix type lettuce. But this will all be lettuce right in here. So a couple days ago we came out and it was raining really hard. It had been raining for a couple days, and all of these walkways were flooded, and the water was almost up to the top of the actual planting bed. The elevation is so that this is lower here and that side is higher. The hill kind of comes down this way. So what we did here is we just dug out a little exit, basically a little channel for the water to exit, because it was just getting trapped into here where it was real low. Because what we did here, after it got tilled up, we dug the walkways out. So actually the walkways were probably about 4 inches lower than everything else. And at that point, we didn't have these wood chips in here. so whenever the water landed in there, it just got trapped because that was the lowest point. So we went and dug these channels out here so that the water could exit. We were gonna try to record that, but it was raining so hard we couldn't get the camera out and record that. But I just wanted to give you a little update there. There's a lot of little things like this that we come across where we just have to make changes as we go. It's kind of part of learning. I kind of saw it, but I thought to myself, nah, there's not enough water that's gonna be collected. But it rained and sure enough, it got flooded. So that was actually probably about a week ago. And then about the last 3 days, it's rained pretty good and we haven't had any issues. So it seems like this is a good fix for that system. Thanks for watching this garden update. Please hit the like button if you enjoyed this video. We are enjoying our time here on the homestead. Every little moment of it, constantly learning. Thanks again for watching. Hope you have a wonderful day.